like me, many of you love our world of frogs. Now, while you might have seen the frogs here on display, I'm not sure you've seen what we're doing out the back. So come with me and I'll show you what some of our incredible scientists are up to.
Welcome.
Hey, Dion. So this is Dion. He is in charge of the frog bunkers. So this is what we call the Baw Baw Bunker. Dion, what are we doing here?
So in here we've got a population of captive Baw Baw frogs. So these are the individuals that we breed for release and reintroduction back into the wild.
And you're all dressed up in a fancy outfit. What is that all about?
So this is just a bit of protection for us and the frogs. We manage all of these frogs because they're going back into the wild under really strict biosecure and quarantine conditions. So it's just to protect them, keep them nice and healthy so that we can ensure we're releasing really healthy frogs back to the wild. Baw Baw Frog is one of those frogs that, you know, is a little brown frog that looks like a bit of mud. and they're endemic to Victoria, so pretty special. They're found in the Mount Warble Plateau, so a couple of hours from Melbourne. And sometime in the mid-80s, chytrid fungus was introduced to the wild up there. And since then, they've declined from probably many hundreds of thousands of individuals down to, now we estimate, probably fewer than 500, so wow. It's pretty drastic. They're a very special frog, and we've been working with them at the zoo for the best part of 10 or 11 years now, where we've established a captive insurance population, and now those frogs are bred up, and we're able to experimentally release them back to the wild.
And that's incredibly exciting. I can't imagine the joy of actually putting animals back in the wild when you've been working with them, breeding them in captivity, and you know this is the lifeline for a species. How does that feel?
Yeah, it's pretty amazing, especially when you put it into context of what we've been doing and the declines and how quick it's been. So in the time that we've started the program at the zoo, we've seen the population go from, you know, a few thousand and drop every year by halves down to the level that we're at now. So we initially knew almost nothing about the species in captivity. We collected some eggs and now we're at the point of actually being able to breed them reliably each year and be able to get those eggs back to the wild. It's a pretty incredible feeling and we're having successes with that as well. We've got a long way to go, but certainly it's in a pretty positive space compared to what it was a decade ago.
I love the story that you're trying something really new. You know we can look after frogs here at Melbourne Zoo. We have an incredible behind the scenes facility, and yet you're trying to experiment on how we can help them get a head start in the wild as well. And you've been working on a project to give them a wild beginning.
Yeah,
how
exactly.
Does that work?
So one of the trickiest things with Baw Baw frogs is they spend almost their entire life underground. So they call from underground, they breed underground, their eggs and larvae develop underground. So we've had to develop techniques to try and get the eggs that are laid in captivity back to the wild, get them underground so they can develop in darkness as they would as you know, a normal healthy Baw Baw frog in the wild. And to do that, we've developed these extremely complex techniques by essentially burying these buckets, which we call overposition sites,
really high
into
tech
the ground.
Buckets.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely, and it's worked perfectly so far. It's really simple. We put a series of sort of filtration holes and things like that in, but essentially we can get the eggs that are laid in captivity in a secure spot in the field, and they've developed really well over the last couple of years. We've taken up many hundreds of eggs and larvae that have been laid at Melbourne Zoo, and they've developed into little metamorph frogs that have dispersed into the wild. So hopefully we'll be able to re-establish some wild populations that way.
So my challenge out to all our members and people watching this is there must be a better technical term than bucket. But effectively what you've done is just so incredible. It's rethinking how we can help frogs at scale, at low cost, by using the natural environment, the natural cooling cycle that happens in their environment. So just an incredible story. And so coming back to the Baw Baws, 500 left maybe in the wild. How many do we have here at Melbourne Zoo?
It varies between about 380 to around sort of 450, something like that. So depending on what we're releasing back to the wild. But importantly, the population now at Melbourne Zoo is genetically more representative than what is actually left in the wild, which is incredibly sobering to think about. It feels like a lot of responsibility, but now that we're getting ahead with the recovery program, we're in a really good position to start getting those frogs back out.
So thinking of the future, Dion, and what do you dream and hope for these little brown, live underground, in the dark, all the time frogs?
The dream would be to get them back into a point where we can hear them calling across their historical range of where they were found. Currently, we're working in these really remote, isolated, protected pockets of habitat. But the stories from, you know, back in the 50s and 60s were that they were across the entire plateau. So all the way through the alpine village that exists now, you could hear choruses of Baw Baw frogs calling. So it'd be incredible to think in the next, you know, decade or two, we could go up there, you know, just as an everyday visitor and experience Baw Baw frogs calling in the wild.
Well, I'm not going to let you go without asking you to do that. So can you do a Baw Baw frog call?
I can have a go for you.
Very good. I'm sure you'll join me in all wanting to hear those little Baw Baw frogs calling right across the plateau. The work that Dion's been doing over the last decade really has saved a species, and that's what it means to be a conservation biologist and ecologist, and incredible work. Thank you, Dion, for all the work you've done.
No worries.